Thank you so much for coming. We are overwhelmed that you are so many. We are very pleased to see you all, to come here and listen to the project about demonstrating economic impact of public libraries. And we are very happy to be here, and we thank Devora Bastik to host here. And we are very pleased to be here today. We have until 1 o'clock, and I know that some of you are leaving a little bit earlier, so we will try to be flexible in the program, so we hope that you all could hear our presentation. We have a long day, or not a long day, but this is us. We have 3 hours with lots of information, because we will not only listen about the project, but you will also hear about the situation in Denmark, something about the challenges that the Danish public libraries are facing, and also the think tank, because I'm managing the Danish think tank for libraries, and August is assisting with projects and communication, especially he's the expert in communication. And so you will also listen a bit, hear a little bit about how we are working with getting more attention to the role of the libraries now and in the future. And of course, why we are gathered here today is because I think you are interested in knowing a bit about our projects, the Danish project, Economic Impact of Public Libraries in Denmark. And not only the results, but how is the process, what was the background, how is the process to do such a project, and of course the results and the effects and impact afterwards on especially politicians. Part of this project, the European project that we will explain to you later, why we are actually here, because all around in the world they're actually doing the same exercises, trying to find out how to find new way of advocating for libraries, for public libraries, and one of the ways is demonstrating with dollars, economic numbers. So we will tell you about the project in the UK, in England, where they have done the same, just looking at other another case. Sometimes I speak very quickly, so you just have to say stop. I don't understand. I'm Danish, as you know, I'm used to explain this in Danish, and I'm not really used to explain this in English. So you just say, I don't understand what you said. Don't be afraid to ask questions. Don't be afraid to say, hey, can you repeat that? Use some other words. We are all in the same situation. It's not our native language, so please stop and please ask questions. And do that all the time, because we have arranged in the... Oh, can we have the program again?
Yes.
In the end, we will have some discussions, some reflections, and all the time we have prepared some questions, because we want you to reflect and think a little bit about how you could do this in your situation. But if you have questions while we are explaining, just raise your hands, and we will try to answer them as good as we can. And maybe we will begin to answer some of the questions that we have prepared for the end. So this is a flexible meeting, even though we want to tell, we will tell you all. We have 55 slides, so don't worry, there will be a lot. But ask questions wherever you feel like. And especially in Denmark, sometimes I speak as something is very logic and very natural. So you just say, maybe it's not the same here in Croatia. I really don't know. I know we are almost the same population. In Denmark we are 5.5 million. Here you are 4.4. You just had a legislation 2 days ago. You had a former ex-social democrat government. It's the same in Denmark. Now we have a liberal government. The amounts, 1 krone is the same as 1 kuna. So it's the same. So we actually have lots of similarity. One thing is not the same. August said, oh dear, there are lots of women in here. Because in Denmark, I see one and one cameraman, and then August, 3 men. if I had this much money. In Denmark, I think it would be a little bit more, about 30%, but it's almost four. Sorry, I missed one. but it's all. It's in Denmark. We will be about 30 or 40% of men. So
there are managers in Croatia.
Yes, and I think it's no. That's I actually don't know. They are managing, and they don't have the time to go in. So that's maybe why. But as this is a question, and of course we will also have some breaks. 3 hours. We're not supposed to sit down in 3 hours, so there will be a break. And I hear there's a half past 11. There will be a coffee. But maybe if we get tired, we open the doors, get some fresh air, and get this beautiful weather that you have here in Denmark. It's 10 degrees, so we are very pleased. Yeah. So you will tell us why we're actually here.
I'm also very pleased to be here. It's very, very nice, especially as a man in this audience. it's very nice. And what I'm going to tell you about, just to begin with, is our project, because we got some foundation from this foundation called the Reading and Writing Foundation. And we went to the UK, to London, last week, and now we're going here, and we're going to Barcelona and to Brussels. And we have our first meeting with the MEP, a Danish MEP, the member of the European Parliament, next Monday. She's a member of the cultural board in the European Union. And what we are trying and what we got the foundation for is to find out with our study, which looked at the impact of public libraries, to look at how is it in the different European countries, in different parts of the European Union, how would this kind of argument, how could you use that to advocate the local politicians, but also at the EU level, because as you know, everything is getting more and more. The decisions are made on a European level. So that's why we started the project, and the Reading and Writing Foundation gave us our foundation. It's also for us. It's important to look at how can you use also to develop the public libraries, not only in a political advocacy methodology, but to look at how can you use it to develop a public library that is optimal for the users and for the citizens of the country and for the European Union in general. So it's two ways. It's both on the local level and it's on the political level and the European level. Yeah, we have this. We have this for country. Sorry, I forgot Netherlands, but that's in January. We're trying to go out there and to tell about our study and also some of the other countries made some studies both in the Netherlands and also in Spain and the UK to look at what did they find out and can we look at some similarities? Can we look at something that is common for all of the European Union that can be used everywhere? And then we're trying to share knowledge to look at, also that's why we're not just going to stand here and talk all the time. We want the dialogue, we want to know what is actually important for you and what can we, with our study, use, how can you use that? And then to debate, to explain for the politicians and the decision makers how public libraries are so damn important. We have those. What we also want to do is to make these key messages when we've been around in these different countries to see is there some similarities that can be some key messages for the members of the European Parliament and for the EU in general. Do we see some similarities, some challenges, but also some positive things that you don't just find out by just looking at it, but can we actually find something that we have in common? Everyone. Yeah, and then we're having a network also with you, Mariana, to look at to have a how do you call it, a board where we're sharing knowledge and where we're trying to find out where we have this, where we can use each other as member states. And then I will give the floor to Lotte to tell about the Danish wonderful think tank.
Thank you so much. I just have to find out. Now I will just very briefly explain to you why we have a think tank, and that is to give you an impression of what is the situation in Denmark. What are the challenges for the public libraries? What are the trends? What do we see? And why do we actually have this think tank that is a gathering of libraries, libraries organization, trying to get a renewed focus on the role of the public libraries with the basis on knowledge. So to reach both the libraries themselves, to get them to get information to develop the library and the library services, but also especially to get attention of the politicians, the decision makers, about the role of the public libraries. But I will explain how we work, but in the beginning I will just tell you a little bit about the situation in Denmark and what we see. And that is also one of the reasons why they started a think tank at all. First of all, we have, I don't know if it's the same here in Croatia, but in Denmark we have seen a decrease in people using libraries. Due to many different things, mostly because of the digitization, that people can go everywhere, they do not need to go to the libraries. But one of the things that is really, I just have to see this one. We try to see, okay, if the development continues, the decrease that continues to go on, there will be from about 50% of the Danes using the libraries, it will be 60% only 40% of the Danes using the libraries in 2020. So if the libraries don't react, don't do something else, it won't be very good. Especially because one of the most important target groups, the young people, there's a big decrease in using libraries, and we know that the library use is like this. So if they don't use it as young, then they will really not use it as when they get older and when they have kids and really getting old. So libraries really have to change, to be more attractive and more relevant to the young people. And another thing is that, is it really a public library? Because people using the library the most in Denmark are the one with the best education, the one with earning the most money, and not really the one, this one, the mature woman with no education, maybe with no job, who could actually benefit a lot of using the libraries. That is one of our report of our studies that we did to do a segmentation of the Danish population, showing lots of things, but one major message was that the public library wasn't really a public library. It wasn't new knowledge, but now we really have some statistics, some data showing it. Another thing is this, I saw yesterday people on the smartphones, I think it's the same thing. There's a hardcore competition about the users. We're talking Facebook, Candy Crush, Farmville or Heyday, I don't know what it means, but there's really a competition of getting the user's attention. And the libraries, they are not, how to say, they don't have the same muscles as Facebook and Candy Crush and all the other actors. There has been a survey in Denmark saying that there are 700,000 non-readers in Denmark, and it doesn't really have to do with education or what people are doing. It's because they're busy. They are so busy, so they don't have the time to read. And when they have some time, spare time, they do the Facebook. They don't take a book. And this is actually linked to this competition, because what are the library using the budgets for? In Denmark, everything starts with an M, but I cannot translate like that, because they're using on materials, buildings, and personnel. So they do not, if you ask, I ask lots of my library managers, say, okay, how large is your budget for marketing? We don't have a budget for marketing. So how will you actually compete with Facebook and Candy Crush if you don't have a marketing budget? Because they use it all on these three other... So for many target groups, the library is actually a secret library. We had done some qualitative studies with students and young people in different cities, and they say, we don't know that you can actually, you have all these services in the public libraries. We never heard about it. We don't know it. So this is just because I'm very proud of having our former Minister of Culture to one of our conferences when we were launching one of the reports. And she said, 35% of the Danes are using the library often, and thereby win once per month. That's not good enough. We really had to do something about it because the libraries really have a fantastic, important role in the knowledge society. But it's just to show that we actually got the Minister of Culture to one of our conferences. Another thing that I think I just spoke a little about, that we in Denmark, we have a fantastic platform for digital books, the e-books. So we see that the digitization as a challenge, because people will go and find their books on other platforms than the libraries, go to find information on other platforms than the libraries, and people will be reading books, not going to the libraries, but reading books at their iPhones, at their tablets, whatever. So what about, and we know at a European level there are lots of issues, I'm sure you discussed this too, but to have access to the electronic books and literature. But what is the future of the printed book? Is it really the dead of the book and dead of the libraries? Happily, we see other tendency in Denmark. They actually, both young people and lots of other people are still very addicted to the physical book. They want the physical book. They want to go to the library. But there are some challenges here. What we see, some of our own studies shows us that the differences between the physical and digital libraries are equalizing. So if you ask for the, do you expect to be a physical library user and a digital library user in 3 years, it's actually equal. So that's, I think it's an interesting development to see that people are in Denmark are really going to be completely digital users, and they don't really, it doesn't matter if it's an electronic book or is it a physical book. And we can also see that we have an explosion in people reading ebooks, both from the libraries and buying ebooks. Another thing we see is that this the digital behavior and expectation are transferred to the physical area. So they ask for the same. They want the same access. They want the books now, and when they want to go to the library whenever they want to. So the old situation, having libraries open from 10 to 4, is almost not existing in Denmark anymore, because we have this open libraries where libraries are open from 6 in the morning to 10 o'clock in the evening, even if there's no librarians. People just check in with their card, and some are even open 24 hours 7. So this access is one of the most important things to keep the users and the non-users, or to keep the users and to get non-users to go to libraries. Another thing I'm sure you heard about, the IFLA trend report, but this, the fact that there are differences in the access to information. And in Denmark and in everywhere, there will be an inequality in the access to information and therefore in the digital education. What we see in Denmark is that we're doing this PISA study, yeah? That Denmark is actually number one in the PISA study to access. Everybody's having computer, iPads at school and at home, so it's not the access that's a problem. But an interesting thing is, if you look at this, we are only number 18 in the digital reading skills. So even though if you have the access, we are not that very good to use it. Even though people, and I think that's really, really scary in a way, young people spend at least 4 hours per day at a tablet, a cell phone, or computer. That's a lot. There's an awareness of how people develop socially, intellectually, if they spend too much time on tablets. So that's it's just the, in the beginning to say, okay, maybe it's not that good to be on the digital platform all the time, because you lose both brain capacity and you lose some social skills. Another trend, I don't know how it is here in Croatia, but we are moving to bigger cities. People want to live in, we have three big cities in Denmark, Copenhagen, Aarhus, and Odense, and you have people live there, the companies are moving there, even though the new government wants to do the opposite, but that's something. And that means you also have very, very different conditions for the libraries, because in the bigger cities you have these super libraries who can really embrace all the many tasks of the modern library, not only lending books, but doing a lot of other tasks. I don't know if you heard about the Dokken in Aarhus, the new, very expensive and high promoted library. It's got 500,000 visitors from since its opening, but it's a big investment. And if you see this is in a small town outside 60 kilometers from Copenhagen, where they're closing the small libraries. So you really have small villages, small towns with no schools, with no grocery shops, with no libraries, with no really some common platform to be in. So that's also a development or a challenge we see, depending on how you see it, because I think you really need super libraries. I think you need libraries to adapt and to be able to have multitasking in many ways. But this, I think that's the most important aspect, that is our new prime minister, Lars Løkke Rasmussen. I just heard it's almost the same, but culture, there are no money. Politicians are not spending money in culture. At the moment, we are in the period of reforms and in savings in Denmark. So we really see that the municipal costs are reducing, and of course that affects libraries. But at a national level, the spending on cultural activities are all reducing. So there's a 2% reduction, that is 600 million kuna. And that's a lot for museums, libraries, and theaters. But I think the most scaring thing is that there's been a recent survey 3 days ago that shows that 50% of the Danes would reduce cost on cultural activities to spend them on health, on education, and the elderly. So it's how you look at the cultural institutions such as the libraries, the people do not really think they have that much importance. So these are local politicians, the ex-mayor of Copenhagen and from Bornholm, small island, and from another small village, saying, we are sorry to say, but there are no votes in libraries. It's not sexy. So libraries on the political agenda, the library is non-existent. And that is if you see it at a national level and you see it at a local level. So that is some of the reasons. Now I took some of our own results and our own surveys, but that was some of the reasons that the major library organization, the Danish Library Organization and the Association of Danish Public Library Managers and Research Libraries, and 30 libraries, Danish libraries, started this think tank where we are working. The think tank, we're trying to generate new knowledge to put in the debate, both in the professional debate, but also the public political debate about the role and development of libraries. And we do it in all kinds of different ways. We do workshops, we do surveys, we do network and projects and conferences and workshops. So that is how we work. This is some examples of the different activities we have. We did this segmentation of the libraries. We have been looking at how many volunteers are working at the libraries. We have done a specific study about students and the reading preferences to say, okay, are they really that digital or do they really still prefer physical books? And that is very good, because if you when I had our prime minister before and the politicians, we know that there's a power of numbers. If you go to, if you want to tell a story, numbers work. Especially if you want to go to this in the papers, if you want to get a story in the newspapers about the libraries, it's very difficult to say, okay, I have a good story telling a library that are doing a fantastic case. Well, we don't care. Let's say, but if you say, okay, 50% of the Danes prefer the digital book, okay, then you get the journalist's attention. But before we did this study, we had not a problem, but the politicians weren't that interested in discussing with us, discussing the future role of the libraries. So this is actually why, one of the reasons why we wanted to do a different study. As we said before, now we're going to discuss this, but before we do that, I will ask just one question. Do you recognize these challenges that I explained to you?
Yes.
Yeah, yeah, it's the same.
Yes.
Yeah. So no news. No. Okay, well, that's good. Well, at least I don't know if it's good, but it's interesting, because then we have a really common platform to discuss with. So how do you discuss these challenges? How do you address them to politicians?
It depends on different levels.
Yeah.
You have to work on the local level, especially in smaller cities.
Yeah.
And then if you are examined, maybe it's easier with that to contact the ministry and try to even to give some examples, solve some problems and so on. But in a smaller community, it's difficult because you depend completely on the local government.
On the local government, yeah.
And they can be completely deaf to you.
Yeah, yeah. Are any of you from a small city?
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. And that is, it's difficult to get in contact? Or?
Almost the same. It's same story. My ex-manager said to me, I give money for a fire department, firemen. Yeah? They are my voters.
Yeah.
And people who go to library, it's not important. It's not very important. It's not. It's not important to election for him.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's
exactly. It's the same. Yeah. And it's incredible. Well, because I think that all around the world, also Denmark, of course, the experience is the same. How do we access the political level? How do, at both local and national level? And as you see, this is some of the countries: Denmark, UK, Spain, Australia, the UK. They have actually been doing studies, and I know that they are thinking about doing it in Chicago, in Finland, and Norway. This new ways of getting attention, getting arguments, some other channels to get in contact with the politicians, and also the broader public, of course, because they're the voters. But so now we will actually start. This was just a warm up. So now we will start the and you ask questions if you feel like. The presentation of. Our report, our study, and also the study from the UK. And what we will do, we will give you a bit, maybe there will be some repeatings, but there will be a bit of the background, why did we actually do this, about the process, how did we do it, what kind of methods do we use, and of course the results. But we could send the results in 5 seconds. No, that's not true, but it's numbers. I think it's very, one of the things that's very interesting is also to discuss, okay, how, what did we expect to get and what did we actually get out of it in the end. So, I would just have a little bit more. As I think everywhere in the world, the role of the library is changing. They're doing much more than just books, having lots of other welfare tasks, a broader library. But when we look at how are they measured, it is always in user satisfactions and book loans. And there's really not a match between what the library actually is doing and how they're measured. And that means when the Danish, I think it's the same with you, the Danish library managers go to discuss library matters at the local municipalities, they ask, how are the book loans? Well, but you do not hear what we're doing for these young kids, you do not hear what we're doing for these immigrants, and they don't listen. Because, okay, what's the book loans? What are the user satisfactions? And that is a very simple way, a very, not stupid, but not, very simple way of measuring libraries. And what, another thing is that often when you focus on libraries, you focus on the activities. How many activities? How many people? And not of the real impact. And that is very important because that's directly leading to why are we having libraries? What do we want the libraries to do? Why do we want libraries? That is not because that we have 35 million Danes going to the libraries each year, like visitors each year. They could go there and not have a real, there wouldn't be an impact of them going there. So it's trying to move the focus from the output, the activities, to the impact. Because if you do that, you also move the focus and the basis for discussion about what we want to do with our libraries. And also because we need, at least in Denmark, we need some alternatives to this narrative that's very good to explain all the good things the libraries do, but it is very difficult to get in contact with the politicians if you don't have something that, for example, numbers. So to explain, and in many words, what libraries are doing, it's not a good advocacy technique to say. So we needed new advocacy arguments towards both the politician, the officials, and also to the broader to the Danes. Why are we actually having libraries? And everybody else is doing it. Everybody else is calculating, measuring in terms of economy. Why shouldn't the libraries do that? So this is kind of saying, okay, you have to enter the battlefield of welfare discussion because we see the libraries as a welfare institution, so they should as well go with the same argument so that they could compare to health, education, children, schools, to discuss why shouldn't we have a library or more money to the libraries in the end. To get some new input to discuss culture and library, because if not, it's always the same, we always use the same argument. So we really needed some new input and discussions. And finally, we also thought that it could be interesting if you put money on things, then you can always say, is it really worth it? Should we do this because this is more valuable than do that? And I think, at least in Denmark, libraries, to find a new role, they're doing everything. And that is kind of good. It's good trying, because it's also, they're very innovative, and it's good to try to find out what's working. But in a way, I think it's also very important to have the possibility to say, no, we're not supposed to do this, because this is not a library task. So, and how can you do that if you don't have something to measure with? So as an instrument to prioritize, we thought it could be a very good thing. Now I'll tell you shortly about the process. It has never been done before in Denmark, doing this kind of exercise for libraries. So we applied for the cultural the development fund of the Danish Agency of Culture and got 400,000 kroner. It's a lot, but it's not a lot, because this guy, this Christian, he's an economist, and he costs a lot. 3,400 kroner per hour. So if you see 400,000, it's nothing. But we did a classic project setup. We had six libraries, the Danish Library Association, and partnering with this guy. Not in the beginning, I will explain why later. We changed horses in the middle of the project, actually. And that meant that from, we thought it would take 7 months, and that is, it could only, it could, that's a short time. But it's because we decided to use existing data, not to go out and collect new data. So I think in real, it took at least maybe 1.5 years, because there's been a lot of things afterwards. But we changed to this guy, and I think he looks like an economist, I think, with blue jacket and almost like August, but he's got wearing glasses. And they were, we were choosing them because they were actually seeing both some methodologist things, but also they had this thing that numbers, it's good to have numbers, but you have to have the talk, it's both, you have to have the words, the arguments, and the numbers, and in a mixture, it's the best and most effective way of communicating. So they have hard facts, clear stories, so that's, well. We looked, of course, as you do in mostly project, the best practice, who have done this before. In Denmark, as I told you, it's never been done before, at the museums, but they were looking at they were calculating the economic impact as a museum were as an employer, you know, when you are having a library or a museum, the employees pay taxes, you have to hire somebody to clean, you have use electricity, and people are taking the bus, and maybe they buy an ice cream on the way to the library, and you can do some calculations on that. But we didn't find that very interesting, because you could do that at any kind of public institution. Mm-hmm. It wasn't specific interesting for the libraries. And this is actually why we changed economists, because they were trying to do this. And we couldn't say, okay, how can you explain what libraries are doing for education, what libraries are doing for health, what libraries are doing for integration, if that's the only thing you're going to calculate on. Mm-hmm. But there's an ISO standard, I don't know if you have heard about it, but to say, okay, how can you actually measure economic impact? And we didn't follow it completely, but we looked at it and say, okay, we want to do kind of similar, so we can say we're leaning on the ISO standard. And the first one is the value of the users and the non-users, what you normally say calculate in willingness to pay. And that is what one of the things we did. The other thing is the library as an employer, that one I told you about. We weren't interested in that thing because it was too generic. And then a bit difficult, competence enhancement. Okay, what kind of skills does the libraries have an effect on? And that was interesting. So we said, okay, we want to look at number one and number three if you look at the ISO standards. But we also had a very open process. So we said, okay, we want to look at everything, and we don't know where to end. because that was one of the risks in this project. You could say, okay, maybe it will show that it doesn't have a positive economic impact, that it's only expenses. And we had to say, okay, that's a risk we have to take, because at a moment, primarily because as a question of money, we couldn't like continue to find the trigger that or the case that showed a positive economic impact. So we had to say, okay, we're looking at these three cases, and we hope that it's a positive result. This is a nice picture of what we wanted in the beginning, because we wanted everything. We wanted to show the integration, what they did for social inclusion, and we wanted everything. But both because some of it, we couldn't show some of it because of there weren't enough data, because we're building on existing data. So we couldn't say, okay, this is not possible for us to show a link between the library and the case, and also because of money. We had to say, okay, we choose three because that's what we have the money for. We know the libraries are doing much more, but we had to choose three areas or three cases. And then another thing we said to the economist, it was we want everything in money. We want a number so we can do a calculation in the end. Three numbers. And I was explain later that was we did it, but sometimes maybe well you should do it, but it gets some implications. This is the main result. These are the three areas or the three cases. We looked at the cultural and social, and I'll explain later the cultural and social impact at a value at 3 to 4 billion kunas. That's a lot, especially because that the costs of the libraries are 2.5 billion. contribution for reading, value at 2 billion kronas or kunas, and this contribution through digital transition. This shows that libraries are a very good business. I actually did another. I don't know. It's not here. But libraries are a very good investment because the annual costs are 2.5 billion, and if you add all these three together, with a little economic calculations, you end up with a result, an annual income result at 6 billion kronas. That's a lot. So it's really a good business. Yes.
I'm sorry. But can you explain more those three economic impact factors according to the methodology which you have been using?
I will do this now. This is just the main results. This is the cultural and social impact. The first one. The method that we used is this willingness to pay. That is the most common way to do. What we did was not to do our own, they had done so in England. We looked at a Norwegian study, or the economist did, took a Norwegian study, who's the biggest and most robust study of willingness to pay in the Scandinavian countries, and transferred to the Danish context. And what does this tell you about when you say this study is looking at three factors? The first one, that is your own personal use, that I can go to the library and use the libraries. That has a certain amount of economic importance for me. But also the more altruistic way, the use of other people, that other people can go and use the libraries. That's also important for me, that I can see that the kids in school can use the libraries. It's also have a certain amount of economic importance for me. And then the last one the role of the library as a cultural and social institution, meaning that the libraries are actually solving some of the market failure, because if the libraries weren't there, there would only be some specific kind of literature, for example. The most demanded literature, the market of demand and, what is it called?
Offer.
Yeah, offer and demand. That is what this little thing shows, that this would be without the libraries, and the mainstream literature would be the greatest, and there wouldn't be smaller literature. But because we have the library, there will actually be lots or much more small literature, and that actually has people value that. They say it's important that it's only not the mainstream literature on the market or at the libraries. And then the last thing, this is the local function of social cohesion, having a place to be. And we exemplified this in Denmark with that actually many non-ethnic Danes are using the libraries. They're actually using it much more than the traditional Danes. I don't know how to say. But so they actually fill out a local social function. And when we transfer these data from the Norwegian study, or the economists did, they calculated to say, okay, this has an amount of 3 to 4 billion kroner. Questions? Okay. And there are many ways, or not many ways, there's some ways of doing willingness to pay. You can either ask how much is it worth, or you can ask if you should choose between different things. But this is how much is it worth. In England, they had done it, but they have been asking, doing their own service with 2,000 persons. They have done it with asking how much extra they would pay for the library. So that's actually another way of doing it, specific within health questions. The smallest amount, and maybe the less interesting, I don't know, depending on who you ask, because I know lots of libraries have actually used this result. We have lots of Danes going to the libraries, getting their computer skills upgraded. We have statistic data that 50,000 Danes go every year to have follow courses. That is 1.1% of the population. That's not a lot, if you say, but in Denmark, we are really in this digital transition, moving all digital transactions with the public, with the public institution, are through digital information. We do not have letters, we do not have mails. We have this folder, e-box, all our personal information, about schools, doctors, everything is one, taxes in one place, and it's digital, electronic. And of course, the libraries have some effect on that. And again, the economists looked at four areas, public savings and private savings, to calculate. And don't ask, you can look in the, I won't explain how they calculate. It's algebra, it's economist, and I'm studying French, but it's a total saving about 200 million kroners, 200 million kroner. It's not a lot. Do you think so?
It is?
Yeah. What, in the beginning we were a bit, so should we actually present this? Because 200 million kroners or kroner compared to what it costs, and I asked some of the libraries saying, okay, how many people do you have, how many employees at your library is actually taking care of this? Having this computer cafes, places where you can ask how to use my laptop or my iPhone. A small library is 2 to 3 persons. And that is interesting to say, I mean, 2 to 3 persons. And if you add this up with all the almost 500 libraries in Denmark, are they having 1 or 2 persons doing this job for 1.1% of the population? Maybe this money could be better spent. I know that some libraries said, this is very good, we want to continue this, but others said, maybe other professions are doing this job better than we are. So that is some reflection, some afterwards reflection that this can also be useful, this prioritizing. But of course 200 million is a lot, but compared to the general savings in the digital transition, maybe it's not a lot for a very small amount of people. But this is also a very conservative calculation, because we only use this 50%, because that's what we have data on. This is what we have, statistic verified data. We know from other studies that there's approximately, maybe a little bit positive, 500,000 Danes passing the libraries, asking questions, just say, okay, how do I open this packet with my laptop? I don't know how to open it, or where do I go to, how can I enter the tax thing, the tax page? So we also know that there's actually many people going to the libraries with single questions, and they do not figure in this 50,000. And we also know that all the private companies were supposed to have this digital profile to communicate with the taxes and the TDA. And there were 15,000 companies coming to the libraries to get help and information. So it could be larger. But again, the economists were very conservative and said we can only calculate upon what we have robust data upon. This is not a good picture, but then we came to there's 2 billion, not 200 billion. the most interesting number, so don't say 200 billion, it's 2 billion. Yeah, okay, yeah. This value through reading. And what is extra interesting is this, is because the economists have actually looked at how much is that on the GDP, the gross domestic product, you know, the final big national economy, and that is actually the impact. And I think it was one of the most interesting findings because, well, we know it's good that libraries helps people with the digitization, but this that is actually have a positive economic impact of GDP, that's interesting. Because you don't expect it. You don't expect that, okay, the fact that we have libraries is really economic positive. What we did was this logic model, and when August will tell you about the UK project, it's the same way of thinking. And it's an interesting way of thinking. I think this is maybe some of the most interesting change of arguing libraries at the libraries themselves, because where we normally stops is this output. It is okay, how many that we have some activities, and it means that we have 35 million visitors and so many book loans, but this is where we normally stop. But if you take from the input, we have libraries that do having some activities, makes an output, and you have an outcome, it actually means something. But where the most interesting thing is this impact thing, that we actually can see that using library as a child means that you get an increased level of education, meaning higher productivity and therefore an increased GDP. This is the logic model in a very short way of explaining it. It's almost the same as I just said, that libraries are improving children's reading skills. We have data on that. Better reading skills directly affect the educational level, and other studies show that a high level of education produces greater economic benefit. So this is as simple as it gets. Of course, it's not that simple. This is the economists' way of trying to explain us how they calculate this. I don't know if it's that easy to understand, but there's a step-by-step explanation in the report that we put on the chairs. But the fact is that we have, as I told you, we've been the economists have been using existing data from other surveys, other robust surveys with significant and validated surveys. And of course they have made some assumptions, because that is also, this is macroeconomy. So of course it's not the exact science. There are some assumptions. So you have to say, for example, people or kids go to the libraries and they leisure read. And there's about the 40% of the leisure reading is coming from the public libraries. So we say, we know the leisure readings from this piece of studies, we know the leisure reading has an impact on how good you read. So we said, okay, there's a link between the library use and that people go to lend books at the libraries and their skills. 40% of all leisure reading comes from libraries. And the economists said, okay, to be sure that we actually have a significant link, we reduce it with 50%. So it's 20% of the leisure reading having an impact on the reading skills comes from the libraries. So also interesting is that when they calculated the educational, if you have a higher education, of course it generates more money. But the economists took the lowest economists after primary school. So it could be, if we said, okay, if we look even further and say, okay, people getting academic grades, I think we could have had an even higher number. So it's also a conservative calculation. But to be sure of this, we said, okay, we have to be sure that this links, these assumptions that the fact that you go to the library reading as a child really affects your education. We had to confirm this. So we looked at other surveys that we did for 2 or 3 years ago that showed the same link, both that the Danes thought or answered that libraries actually encourage children to read. And I think it was 75 or 74% of the Danes answered that they have used the libraries when in school or at education, asking for help. That showed something that, okay, we could actually have a link between these two factors. But we also did a specific statistic correlation from two separate studies with 1,000 person in each study, where we actually found out that if you have used the library as a child, you improve your chance to get an education with 7 to 9%. And then people will say, okay, it's because of people using libraries, it's because that their parents have higher education and they're earning more. But it was actually, despite this, the statistic took all the relevant data away, so it is actually a clear link between library use and level of education. So So that's very interesting because it does not even have a positive economic impact, but we could actually say that using libraries, you can, how to say that, reduce the social inequality in the society. And that is one of the major Danish problems at the moment, that we really have, from being a country with very equal, we really see inequality as a bigger and bigger problem in education, in health, and in social in general. So this is really an interesting finding. This also brings out, where, as I talked before about the digital, the result within the digital area, this is very interesting, this education thing, because it's a direct product of the library's core competences. It is not something new, it's what libraries are doing the best. It's reading, it's leisure reading. So there's really, it's not something new they have to do. And there's a big potential because now, at least in Denmark, of course you have, as I understand, you have two, you have programs, you have activities, you have projects with improving the reading skills, but it can be improved much more. So this 2 billion kroner or kuna could be even much bigger. Especially if you, if the Danish library started to cooperate and work more systematic with the schools, having more deeply and more systematic partnership with schools. They do have, but not that much. And finally, this we have only been looking at children's reading skills. Of course, libraries are doing much more. They're doing much for high school. So we stop at a moment. So if we looked at the whole cyclus from going to the library as a baby almost to finishing your academic studies, I think we could get a much more important figure or number. So they are, this is only a little part of what libraries actually are doing. Of course, hold something here too. Well, we got a lot of reactions because we have done, before launching this report, we did, or especially August, did I don't know how many weeks of strategic communication. We wanted to get this on the front page in every newspaper, and we did. And August called, I've got a little bit of professional support, but August called and called, I don't know how many journalists telling the story, and we were in all the newspapers. We went to national TV, went to the national radio, talking about libraries and what libraries could do in society. So in that way, we really had a good. It really did have a good effect on getting a broader attention to the public libraries. And now I see, oh, they're coming like that. We also got political discussions. These are mayors or aldermen from three of the largest cities, almost four largest cities in Denmark, discussing this at the annual meeting for the Library Association, the Danish Library Association, discussing with Christian, the economist, where we have asked specific questions about these results and how did it matter for them? Did they look at the libraries in different manners? And with this knowledge, could they say more about where did they see the libraries in the future? And we also had libraries on the local agenda. This is a cultural municipal meeting in Varden. It's a small town far away from Copenhagen, where they had been discussing these results. And that's a very, very, it really has been used as a way to get in contact with local politicians. And the local politician suddenly had great interest because they could see, okay, this is really interesting for me because we have an educational problem in our municipality. We have a problem with reading skills. So I think this really opened up many doors to get libraries on the political agenda, and not only and also for discussion what we want to use our libraries for, which were some of the hope we had for this kind of surveys. But we also got some beatings. It weren't everybody who were happy about our results. These are two articles from cultural conservative. One is from another think tank, and another is a cultural electronic newspaper coming every Sunday evening. They said most of the critics came because the way we communicated the results. We said 4 billion plus 2 billion plus 200 million is 6 billion kuna. That's the result. It's a good business because it only costs 2.5. And they said, you cannot add the willingness to pay with the educational result. And maybe you cannot. But we said, okay, this is an exercise. We say we look at the willingness to pay as an economic, you can say, is it a result? Yes, it is. You can look at it and say, okay, this is actually a result because people are willing to pay that at the moment.
And also the economist said that it was okay.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
He's a professional.
Yeah.
We don't know anything about the algebra, but he said it was okay.
It's okay. He changed a little bit after all the critics. But in the beginning, he said it was okay. So that's what we did. But you can say, if we haven't done this, if we haven't said 6 billion, we said, okay, it's 2 billion, or it's worth 4 billion, it wouldn't have been that interesting. Because people will say, okay, the expenses are 2.5. So it's not, so we really need it to give a positive result in the end. Knowing that it was a press release. So of course you do a little bit more positive. No, not a little bit more positive, but we were a bit, well, on the edge, you can say we were a bit on the edge. Another point of critics was that we used this Norwegian study.
It's, pardon? Sorry, I didn't hear.
Yeah, we used a Norwegian study for calculating willingness to pay. And we knew that. In the beginning, we didn't want the willingness to pay to figure in the report or in the survey. But it was kind of necessary because if we only had education and the digital transition, it would be the negative result in the end. And I think that the willingness to pay is also an interesting way of seeing how people, what's the goodwill? Do people think libraries are doing a good job? But of course it's a Norwegian study, but Norwegian and Denmark are so similar in the library offer, in the social demographic parameters of the population. But what they said was that because it was from 2004, we didn't consider the digital development. But the, what we think and what the economist also said is that, well, but maybe libraries are actually doing more. We have a fantastic offer of digital material, e-books, and people go there using using computers and using it as a space. And in Denmark, we see maybe people are lending less books, but the amount of people going to the libraries are the same. It's equal. So I think it's, well, of course, it would have the optimal situation would have been to do our own willingness to pay. But on the other side, we have hundreds of user surveys saying that libraries are important. For, I love my libraries, and that is for both users and non-users. So it's wasn't a good critic, I think. It was okay to say it would, in the best of all worlds, we would do our own survey, but it's a robust and okay to use this.
Yeah, and I mean, also when you take economists like this company, Copenhagen Economics, that we use, and when he's saying that it's okay, I mean, then you also have to trust this professional, because we are not economists, and when he say this can be used in Denmark because it's so similar to this country, I mean, then I think it's solid,
yeah.
It's okay to use that figure, and that was also what we said.
Yeah. But I think one of the major reasons why we got some beatings with this. This is actually libraries are heroes and not supposed to be measured in dollars. Instead, they should tell the good story. That is our former Minister of Culture saying this. And just to do this exercise, just to say, okay, we want to measure culture, it really, sorry my Danish, pissed off some people. Especially these traditional cultural, we have some a group of important persons within the cultural sector that think this is not okay to do. And of course they could get gathered together and say this is horrible what they have been doing with the libraries. Now we all had to go and measure, and then we had to battle between each other who is making the most economic impact. Is it the theaters, the libraries, the So it's been a quite interesting also, because I think even some librarians managers said were very angry, saying, okay, this is really the wrong way to go, and we just have to tell the good story. And but when you say, okay, but it doesn't work, how would it get in contact with the politicians just telling the good stories? And then they said, okay, well, you're right. Even though I'm not we don't completely agree, we think it's a good exercise. You really got a specific focus, and even at the broader public, Danes coming saying to libraries, say, wow, is that really what you're doing? I knew you were important. So so I think the exercise has been very important, and especially this way of thinking, to say, okay, we do this, the output is this, and the impact is something else. So how can we actually begin to work and think in this more strategic way, actually, to say, okay, we do something, but it actually has to have an impact in the end. And then I forgot two more. There was also this critics that this is only three ways of looking at what my libraries are doing, and they're doing much more. And then we just had to say, yes, of course, but we didn't have enough money to do everything. We would have loved to do it. Yes?
I have a question or a comment. Well, I wonder myself, I see it as a problem when politicians are involving in this kind of a matter, because maybe
they started this database when they saw your project in media, so it's a kind of a propaganda for them, in election time especially.
Propaganda for the libraries, you say?
No,
for
them.
For the politicians. Yeah. That they could use it?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, but I think that, first of all, this is national data. So we haven't been at a local level. And we would have loved to do it.
I think it's one of the...
Well, we would have loved to do that. To do data, because they've been really asking, how is it in my municipality? I want to know what it's like in my municipality. But as a... I don't think it's propaganda. I think people are saying this is propaganda for the libraries, but maybe not for the politicians, because I think they can use it in the already non-existing. They're not discussing libraries, so I think the fact saying okay, we look at our local area, saying we have problems with reading, for example, we know now that it actually. Libraries actually has a really good impact on that. Maybe not calculating in terms of money, but just the fact that you do this links, I think that's, yeah. Did I answer your question or not really?
Yeah.
Okay. The last thing is, this is not an exact science. We had made some assumptions, and people were saying, how can you actually do what I explained before? How can you link the leisure reading to the reading skills? But I think we, first of all, this is macroeconomics. You're saying this is not, there are some assumptions in macroeconomics. And we had, as you said, August, we had economists, specialists, one of the best in Denmark to calculate on this. And we had to rely on what they're saying were right. And we did all these extra studies to say, okay, we can actually, with other studies, prove with statistic data that these links and these assumptions are right. I think that it gave us, afterwards, if you say, okay, how we finished now and people are still using the results of the report in different debates. I really think we got a new argument in the public debate about the role of the libraries. We got this linking to, okay, it's a good investment. It's actually a good idea to invest in libraries because not only is it good for people, but it actually has a positive effect on the economy. And I think that is a fantastic link, not only for libraries, but for the cultural sector in general. Saying, okay, it's not stupid. Well, as I showed you before, you cannot directly see it on our new government's investment in libraries, but linking these things together. I think it's an interesting thing to do, having a new way of looking at libraries too. And it changed, I think it changed a lot. We had a really good main focus on the library's main task and core competences, because the educational part and was the most interesting and is really one of the core competences. So this to be to connect libraries with the reading and the core competences part is quite interesting, because libraries have been criticized of doing too many things, too much Disneyland, too much doing everything else than the main library tasks. We had a new focus on thinking libraries working together with other partners, especially the school. Really an eye-opener saying, okay, this is not, we're not doing this good enough. We really have to exploit this potential of doing more connection with the schools.
And in addition to this was also that the librarians were thinking of themselves in a different way. There's, as we also discussed with the UK project about this, a lack of confidence within the librarian profession. But to say, okay, you really have a societal impact, and it changed the way of looking at themselves. And finally, we took the first step. This was, it's not the perfect study, it's not, we can develop, but it's the first step to try to argue in different manners. And libraries managers are asking for more. They both want more data in the local area. They want to look, maybe not in Kuna, but they want to look at what they're doing, having focus on the impact area. Saying, okay, what we do actually matters for society. So how can we start there instead of discussing book loans and user centers? I think it's really moved a way of thinking and arguing and advocating for libraries. So, I think it's time for a break. Some of you are going to leave. So you don't, the people leaving, we are going to discuss the English case in a moment. There will be a short break.
Yeah.
20 minutes?
Yeah.
It's enough. It's enough? 20 minutes, yeah.
So, I'm just going to briefly introduce the British study. Because last week we went to a guy which is with the Arts Council in London, a rather British guy called Brian Ashley. He was telling us about his or the UK study, and they focused, like we focused on the education part and the digitalization and the willingness to pay. They mainly focused on the health issue, like how's public libraries increasing the health level, and what is the saving for society, and also the willingness to pay, where they actually asked 2,000 citizens about their willingness to pay. So first, and then also the happiness, because you can see that the first thing they looked at was that if you actually use the public libraries, you get to be a happier person. You have a higher life quality, like if you see here it's 1.4% the likelihood of reporting a general positive health if you use the public libraries. And I mean that's a good fact also to use in this context. The second, what they looked at was the health issue, and there they said that 1.32 pounds per person per year is saved for the country in medical expenses if the person goes to a public library, and that's actually a lot. And I mean, what we also talked with Brian Ashley about was that this is not just the UK. You can look at that in many other countries and use that, because for example, he used it in local places in the UK. He looked, when he went out and spoke to audiences there, he said, like in your community, maybe you have 10,000 people, and then it's 1.32 pounds per year that is saved in medical costs. And I think what we also talked about was that it could be very interesting to see, could you look at that in a European level? Could you say that there are some similarities which could provide us with the opportunity to say that cipher is actually a general thing around Europe, and that's an estimate of 27.5 million pounds per year in savings just to go to public libraries. And there they also had a lot of calculation where they took out all the other factors. Because like Lottie also said before, that typically the people going to public libraries, they're typically well educated and they're well paid and so on. But they took out all those factors and just looked at the use of public libraries increases the general health, and therefore you don't have to use medical costs as much. What they also did, and what we also talked about before, and also just briefly in the break with some of you, was that you have to have a person or a method which is solid, where you don't have to discuss always, is this right? Like, for example, the 4 millions and the 2 millions and so on. We use Copenhagen Economics, which is like a very, very well-known company for those kind of economic calculations. And in UK, they use this method called the Green Book, which is recognized by the National Treasury. So what they did was they did, this guy Brian didn't want to discuss all those, like the method, why can you do that or can you not do that, is that solid or is it not solid? So he used what they call the Green Book, which is like a method which is in discuss, where people don't discuss it, like in when you go out and speak with people, when you just say you use the Green Book, then they're like, okay, that's fine. Then the economics are in place, and that's interesting, because that if you should do a similar study here or everywhere else, you have to have a someone which is solid and which people don't discuss the mythology about. So that was briefly on him. And what I also just can say just very briefly was that when we had the focus on the big national scene and we got out in the national media and so on and got a lot of debate and discussion, the focus in the UK was more the corridors. It was more to look to make a study and a survey which would actually advocate the politicians in the corridors, where they didn't go to the media and so on, but he advocated it for the members of parliament in London, where he went there and he gave the report and the study and said, this is what public libraries are worth, and if you're cutting budgets, then it has a consequence, because general health in life happiness and the people actually wants to pay, the willingness to pay, it's like Lotte said before, that it's extra. They looked at the extra amount, where we looked at just like how much would you actually pay for public libraries as it is now. They said you pay this much now, how much would you pay extra? So that was a different kind of study, which was very, very interesting, and which was different than ours, especially with the focus on the corridors and looking at advocating in a indirect way, where we looked at the direct way and the big national scene. So that was actually briefly on the UK on the UK study. I think we'll jump to the conclusion now.
You can say several of you came to me in the breaks asking, do you know the Spanish report? And we are going there in 2 weeks. So we will also have the results in the end of the project from the Spanish project. But we haven't been there, so we think it's better not to to present their results. But I think if we should conclude of both the Danish study and the UK study on how if we should conclude something on these two studies. First of all, it works. It works to the power of numbers and the power of dollars, that people, libraries, politicians can calculate, can make the link, okay, what we do is actually, it's a number, it's a good thing. It's a good way to access the policy agenda. It's not the only way, and it cannot stand alone. It's not. It's like you cannot just say, tell the story and say it's worth 6 billion. You have to connect it with the narratives. So these balances between using numbers and words and stories are of course important to find out how to balance these things, because it's not valid or not. It's not a question about being valid, but it's not good only to have one or another. I think we discussed with with Brian Ashley in London was this robust evidence. It's very important, and I also discussed it with some of you in the break, that if you use data, if you use collecting data, it must be robust, because it's very important to not to argue about the validity of the data. And as August said, it's good to have a recognized method just to clear the road for the arguments. And we didn't use the same methodology as in England, and it made maybe the road a little bit more difficult, but nonetheless a good effect. I think it's an important tool to change the perception of public libraries, both for the politician, the publics, and also for you. How do you look at your work and what you do for society? Both in England and in Denmark, we have this crisis of identity or lack of confidence. And the fact that you can actually, you can put yourself in an impact, connect yourself with a societal impact is interesting. And I think it's a good way to get more professional confidence. I don't know if it's the same here, but at least in Denmark, librarians are saying, okay, what are we actually doing in this world? Why are we here? And we're trying to find out, give us some answer, find out why we're here. So this is not the only answer, but it's one answer to say, okay, you actually, this is why you're here, this is your mission, this is what your work actually affects in the end. Another thing that if you want to do some of these studies, it's important to know why you're doing it. What do you want to achieve? Is it just to get, like we did, we wanted to really to say, okay, we want to put libraries on every front page. Of course, it wasn't the end goal, but it was important for us to turn the negative story about the libraries. The example in UK was different. Was more strategic tool to use as a strategic tool, and of course also to affect the policy agenda, but in another way. But to know why are we doing this? Because it's not an exercise just for the exercise. It will never be a good result. And then to choose a case, to say okay, or maybe two or three cases. You cannot do everything. It's not possible. It would be too expensive, and it's too difficult to explain all the libraries are doing. It's okay to say, okay, we have three cases or two cases like they did in England, instead of wanting to explaining it all. Had to cut it into pieces. The story about the elephant, you know, it's easier to take some pieces. And I actually think that's a very, very important thing. To say, okay, we pick this area because we find this is at the moment the most important area. And then this communication strategy. You can choose different strategies, of course, but it's really a full-time job. August is very good at it, but we also got some professional advice to say, okay, when do we launch? How do we do it? We ask for,
how much money did you spend on this communication strategy, since you were saying about the importance of budgeting marketing in libraries, since we don't have it?
Yes, I did.
You?
We didn't have it.
Anything,
we
right?
didn't have, well, money on ours, I think a month. Yeah, I think we spent a month's salary, at least.
Uh-huh. Okay, that's nothing.
But we got some help from professionals, but you know, we asked them, say, this is such a good story, could you please help us? So, and they did.
Well, okay, but I think it's something that we all do all the time, isn't it? So we are all, I think, in Croatia, but not only in Croatia, in library, we are all doing it, this marketing,
but
our job.
Yeah.
As our...
Yeah. But I think if we should have paid if we should have done the full package, saying, okay, we're going to the television. Okay, if you're not used to go to the television, you need some exercise in going, looking at a camera, and we're going to talk to journalists. So you really have to say, okay, how do I answer them? And you say, okay, I will call you back in 15 minutes. Can you please tell me what's the question about? Blah blah blah. All these things, a training session. And I think it would be about between 75 and 100,000 kroners. And then we got help because we were launching at different stories to different newspapers. And how do you do that? Mm-hmm. And we were launching, we were trying to sell the story at the same day, for example. And then suddenly we could go on the television in the evening. And how could we do that? And there are specific ways of telling, okay, we are launching in an electronic, I don't even remember what you should do, but there are special ways of doing this.
Yeah, but what I mean is that it's not always a question of budget. It's a question of the way that you use the media and the way to use communication. Mm-hmm. I mean, what we did was especially to when we wanted to launch, to call the journalists and to say to get like a personal relation with those kind of journalists and saying, we're going to launch this, we're going to make a press release, you're going to get it now, I'm just going to call you back, what do you think, do you need some more, do you need, like, to help the journalists to make the story for them, and also in the press release to have quotes, to have everything.
Yeah.
Was very easy.
I understand.
Yeah.
Because I was a journalist.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So you're talking about public relations.
Yeah.
No,
yeah,
I,
yeah.
I'm
and we also
asking in a way that in libraries, not just in Croatia, but in other, we usually don't have the person who is responsible for public relations or for marketing. Usually it's a couple of people who are interested in that area.
Yeah.
Mm.
Yeah. But I
so
think that it
I
is.
I don't know if August is someone who did some trainings for public relations and communication strategies.
Yeah. But then I think it's the fact to don't forget to calculate the time and resources. So you cannot say, if you launch a report, for example, then you said, okay, we need in the beginning to do this communication as a journalist, a communication strategy, and to say, okay, we know we're going to spend a month of full-time persons. So he cannot do anything else, or the person cannot do anything else, because it's
okay.
So the way of investing, investing. But then we also did get some professional help, because we needed it, because we were, well, it's, they know how to exactly to when you get not in trouble, but when you suddenly do something you're not sure if you're doing it right, it's important to have somebody to call.
Mm.
But I think also the fact that if you are going on television, you need some training, because it's just not like that. Somebody can do it, but it's a good thing to be trained and to do it before you actually launch something like this. If you have the plan to go in a broader public, I think it's important thing. And then another thing we did was I forgot to mention, but I think it's a interesting thing, because this was national data, but okay, trying to say, okay, we also wanted to involve the local. So how could they actually be involved in selling the stories to their local
communities
and newspapers? So I had three persons with three different stories as concrete examples of libraries, and then also themselves getting in contact with their local journalists. And it actually worked, so we got out in all the local newspapers with specific, with different stories, with concrete examples from the local libraries. So we did both a national plan and then a local communication plan.
Right.
And it was actually very interesting also for the libraries to have a think tank that prepared everything for them and said, okay, you have to contact them at this time, and you use this press release, and then you find your own case and your own story. And it really, for the three person, it was really good for them to do this, be part of this. yeah. And another thing is that, as we discussed with the Brian in London, he didn't have the personnel to do this thing. So it was both a strategic choice to say, okay, this is a corridor instrument, but he said, oh, I would have wished to have had somebody who could do this full time, so to sell the story at a different level. So it's not only a strategic choice, something, it's also about personnel or resources. And then the last thing, you can't have it all. We cannot, we were asked to do everything, and it wasn't possible because it's expensive. It's really, really, really expensive to use this Economist. And that means that you should also really consider the case and all the cases that you want to use. And finally, and I think that's the best actually thinking of it, that libraries ask for, they want more. Maybe you can give it to them, maybe we can do some more studies, maybe not in completely the same way, but to look at the impact and have the focus on the impact and these value chain thinking, I think it's an interesting thing. So that was our presentation. So if you have questions to what we presented, you are very welcome. Now we have been talking a lot, and I think if you're okay, I think we would like to ask you some questions, because we would like to have something in return. No, also because, as I discussed with you earlier, that I know that some of you have been thinking of doing the same, so we want to just a little process, 45 minutes, I think, where you have to discuss a little bit with each other and present in to us what you're discussing about. So we prepared 4 questions, and I think we will be able to do that. Oh, this is it. Boom. Oh, don't matter. I think if you just two minutes, discuss with each other what's the most important finding today. What's the most interesting? What did you? Is there something you learned? Is there something you find especially interesting? Just 2 minutes with each other. Talk to each other. Two minutes. Yeah. I don't know who you want to talk to. Just 2 or 3 together. It's fine. Okay. Do we have anybody who wants to say first? Say, okay, what was the most interesting one? Is there any findings? Do I have any questions that I don't understand? Anyone who wants to? Yeah. You're looking like somebody who wants to say something.
Actually, I want to say something else. I can also. Maybe we are surprised mainly because we have some lot of similarities. We were expecting big differences, something like that.
We can
understand what you are saying.
Yeah.
Because the relations between politicians, economic situations, we also have to make a number. Numbers. How much books are you long? Okay, we have that situation also here. But what I didn't understand, or maybe didn't understand enough, when you were making some picture of what libraries can offer.
Yeah.
How much were you concerned with the reading material, and how much with other stuff, doing things with children?
Only leisure reading books.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's my point.
And that is what I try to explain, saying, okay, we know that this is a simple way of looking at what libraries are actually doing, but it's because it's the only area where we have statistically significant data. So if we have tried to say, okay, we should have done a complete other study, much more expensive, or we would have made, we didn't have data on the other aspects, national data. maybe at some specific libraries, but we didn't have national data.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why we couldn't give a broader picture. And that is also why we say, okay, this is 2 billion kuna. It's a lot, but we could, if we have had a bigger project, we could have shown much more.
Mm.
Yeah.
Yes, we have a similar problem because we also have to make concerning the future of the libraries in the digital era. We had a lot of discussions in the libraries here,
mm-hmm.
in our meetings here, for example, 10 years before. And it was the issue of how much we have to be concerned with the reading materials
mm-hmm.
and with other stuff. For example, doing things with the children from the kindergartens
mm-hmm.
here
yeah.
in Zagreb, it's
yes.
very big
yeah.
business here. A lot of things we do with children that are not primarily concerned with the reading.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's almost impossible to make numbers of this experience.
Mm-hmm.
But it's a lot of experience that children get from mm-hmm. libraries, but
yeah.
they cannot make that into the numbers.
Yeah, and I think, for example, one of the local cases I told you about from one of the local libraries we used, it was actually to show what libraries are doing. It was what is it called, daycare, where they're being kept at home, how the library were cooperating with daycare keepers as an example. So that was the story connected with the 2 billion, with the number, with the fact. So I think what I know that it's not, maybe it's not possible to do a calculation or do the same exercise on for example how they're working with the daycares or with the kindergartens. But what you can do is that you can show it as an example. So you're connecting, you're doing both the talking and the examples and the hard facts. Do you understand what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
So you can show it, but you can show other things by connecting them to
mm-hmm.
to the number.
But actually, in fact, I think it would be possible for an economist to find
yeah.
a number of that
yeah.
because they're actually quite good at taking out other factors and see if it's daycare, if it's taking care of children in some time, how much saving is that for society, how much do they get out of it. And our economist, he had a big because we got the same questions concerning why are you only looking at the reading skills for children. For example, in Denmark, many people from high schools, they get a lot of help with their assignments and to find the right literature and so on, and that makes them better students, and that will maybe make it more possible that they will take a longer education, and that's good for society. But I mean, there are so many things that the public libraries does, and if you have to look at them all, it will be a big report and a big study, and that's a question of where you're looking.
Yeah, and because we were using existing data, and if we don't have data on that, we said, okay, we cannot do it. But we would love to do it, but it's not within our reach, especially the economic reach.
Mm. Okay, I have, that was my introduction.
Okay.
Okay. Okay.
No, you can ask
me. Uh-huh.
One.
Okay. Because the, like you said, the readings that the libraries can offer are the, you could say, main service that they can offer for the society.
Yeah.
So, I think because also, like I said, we had that kind of conversations here in the last 10, 15 years because of the digital revolution and something like that, of the future of the libraries.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so like everybody else, we had to follow what's going on in the technology, in the digital
mm-hmm.
industries, technology itself.
Mm-hmm.
So we had a happy coincidence, I think, during this last maybe 10 years, because main interfaces in digital technologies are still based on words,
mm-hmm.
mainly. You have videos, photos, but mainly on words. But that's not the future.
No.
Virtual reality, artificial intelligence are the future. So Facebook will not be based on words anymore, maybe 5 years more, but that's not the future. So if we are, if the main stuff that we can offer is something connected with reading, and reading is not the future that the digital technologies are interested in anymore, or much less than now, but then will be the real challenge for the...
But that's true, but...
So I think that this last 15 years that we were struggling to find our future is just the easy part.
Yeah, it's true, but other studies show that basic competences within reading and maths are the most important basic competences to go to other digital areas. So I think there are lots of other competences, and I'm not talking about artificial intelligence, but lots of digital competences, lots of others, but the recent studies in Denmark shows that the reading and the math studies are some of the most important to go and have access and to use the broad digital, all the digital platforms. So it's true, and it's, but I think it's also and maybe another project, because this is really looking at the present a little bit in the back, and not so far in the future. But I think you got something very important there, and for example, something we can see in Denmark, we have, which is not artificial intelligence, but we have a big increase in the, you know, listening to books, but digitally, audiobooks, but digitally, and it's especially for people not reading and not using the libraries. They have really adapted this because we have this digital platform. You can both get the e-books and you can get the audiobooks. And it's movies, it's many other kinds of communicating, and it's not in the classic way, but within this study, it's more like at the moment study more than explaining things about the future. Mm-hmm. Another one wants to share what you've been discussing. Have you anything? What did you discuss?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, you can say.
Oh, I don't know where from to start from.
It's okay, but it's fine. Does anybody else has a question or want to? Because then we have another question. Yeah.
Well, I will just comment. Because usually librarians are considered to be expenses. And I think with this studies which would like to research the impact, social impact. I think this will help a lot to our psychology of librarians. So I do agree, and being a librarian, this is the most important part for me of this economic factor.
Yeah.
And what is very important, not a single person can prove the economic impact of librarians, of a single. This is the whole sector. And I think this will be also one idea, that we compare several sectors, cultural sectors, the impact of several other cultural sectors, museums, not the archives, but I think this would also add some more importance to libraries.
Yeah.
Because I think, again, of course, I think I'm thinking many years already, but I think the profession of librarians is really to do everyday work, every day. When you prepare an exhibition, you do it for a certain period of time. Then you open the exhibition, then the public comes, you close the exhibition, and then it is end of it. But librarians are of various parts, of various types of libraries, all the time with their public and inventing so many programs.
Yeah.
So also the public libraries in Croatia are not the same. And this is their value. This is only comment.
Yeah. I don't think. An important comment, and I think in some way it could be interesting to compare with all the other cultural institutions. But on the other side, I think
it is a difficult
one. But I think it would be, at least I think it would be interesting to what we have been discussing is to say, okay, how can we do this for all the cultural areas to actually show how important cultural institutions are.
Mm.
And of course there would be a possibility to compare. And I don't know if I would give the politicians the tools to compare and say, okay, then we, of course, we will put all our money at the libraries instead of putting them in the theaters. I don't want to go there, but that could be an effect or a result of that.
I remember also one study, of the British Library, because you mentioned one of the first studies at the national level of one library, British Library, the impact study. And they proved that £1 invested in the British Library proved, I don't know, £2.1. So it doubled the economic impact of the library. And this is nice to see.
Yeah. It's true. I discussed this, I went to IFLA with in Cape Town with this presentation, and discussed it with several that had done this kind of, because I think that's interesting. I think that's interesting because it's also very easy, for example, to say, okay, in my local area, how much does it mean? But what they were interesting in this study was that this was national results. So how could you put this up at a national level to get some national debates. And because you easily go to, okay, what does it mean for our little local area? And then I think it's, sometimes it's good, but sometimes it's also good to have the more general discussions and debate at a national level. And I think I will end my, anybody else? Yeah.
I have one question.
Yeah.
I can understand which relation is about saving in money in British study about being user of public library and cost savings.
Mm.
Can you explain?
Which one of them, like the general health?
I don't know which method did British study use to measure that impact?
Okay, they first of all, they used this 2,000 people where they actually asked them, that was the willingness to pay, where they said, you pay so much for the public libraries now, how much would you actually pay extra? And then in the other study, they looked at, they had the Green Book methodology, and then they looked at existing data plus this 2,000 people. And they compared it and they said, okay, if you have a person going to public libraries, I mean, investing in public libraries, then you will save this £1.32 per person per year. And on the other hand, you have the happiness, and that is very important also in a health perspective, that if you have someone who is happy, you will not go so much to the doctor and there's not so many suicides and you have many factors, and they are more likely to say that they are more happy with 1.4% if they go to public libraries. And there, all the other factors is taken out. So that's actually the methodology. But it's a big algebra, and I'm not an economist. I'm a law student, so I don't know anything about those kind of things. They were really convincing, and nobody questioned actually the methodology because they used this Green Book method. So that was how they did.
But you can also say we do not know in details. But for example, in Denmark, we cannot correlate data from library use and how often you go to the doctor, the general practitioner. We're not allowed to. They are in England. So that, I think that's big. And that's big difference. What kind of data you have and how is your access to data and how can you correlate data we couldn't, because we don't have, we're not supposed to save data from library use, and especially not, even though if we could, we were not allowed to correlate these two. There's very hardcore statistic law saying what we can do with the personal data. So that is why I discussed it with the statisticians and also from the Danish National Statistics Agency to open up for this, and we're still working on it because some libraries are keeping their library data at a personal level, and we have this kind of security number, and then we are already, all we do, visiting doctors, going to school, going to libraries, and if it could be possible to correlate these, and at the moment it's not possible, because if it had been possible, we could have made other more statistics significant links between all these, where we said, okay, this is assumptions, and we have to support our assumptions with different studies, so we're sure. But in UK it's different, and I cannot exactly say why, but I think they have more liberal laws on using personal data. I'm not sure, but I think that's why. You had a comment?
Yes, at the beginning of your presentation you mentioned some numbers that was very interesting about how many Danish people are users libraries, and this percent of 40% of young people is only users in libraries, something like that. It's not using the libraries.
Yeah.
Is it the problem because of the school libraries that are going there, or the faculty libraries?
Why they're not going to the libraries? Most of the young people don't know about what they actually can do in the libraries. We have asked for all the different services, both the physical and the digital services, and it's they don't know it. There's a lack of knowledge of what you can actually do in the libraries. You have specific groups, for example, this 90%, that's a young school, it's a girl, often going to school, studying. They know it, but they use it for school purpose. But that's the only reason. But we see a tendency in young people using libraries much more for studying and just to be there, to go there to have a look, especially if it's a very nice modern library. But the fact that people are going there for studying groups, there's an increase in that. But it's mostly because they don't know what they can use the libraries for. And they say, some of the other target groups, they say, I find it a good, I don't need the libraries. I want to buy my own books, or I don't read books, or I use Google.
So what about literacy generally in
Denmark? It is, we actually have people going, finishing school after 9 years of school. 25% of them cannot read.
25?
It's a lot. Yeah. So I think it's, we have a high level, but we also have many people. And I'm actually a bit surprised that politicians and libraries don't use it more often to say, okay, we actually have 25% of Danes who finish school who cannot read properly, and see what we can do. Libraries can actually help them. So, So it's high, but it's what we say, we have this increasing inequality in reading, health, social. So, I think we will, we have one more, we have four questions, but I don't think we have room for one more question. I think we will take, it's also a quite open question, a little bit more. We get to see them all again. I think, this is it. You have 5 minutes, you have to really work hard. to find out, and smaller groups like you follow to find out, okay, what is your main challenge here in Croatia? And maybe you have a lot, but if you should think in inspired by how you can use economic argumentation and advocating, try to find one case that you would, if you should prioritize between all the challenges and all the cases that you can use, and just reflect on how could you use economic argumentations. Could it be useful on the case or on the challenge that you find out? So choose one case and reflect on how could economic argumentation have an impact on that. Are you all okay? Hmm? Understand the question? Yeah.
It's difficult.
I know. Yeah, you're not here to sleep, so you have 5 to 7 minutes, and then we make a quick wrap up. Does anybody have an idea about the main challenge, the case, and the reflection? Anybody who wants to?
Mariana.
Yeah, good.
First of all, I want to say that for your first question, we were discussing, and it was Neria's solution. She said that what's the most important thing that we learned today?
Yeah.
And it is that you really persuaded us that we have to learn to accept the rules. Somebody else sets the rules, and today, I mean, economy is lingua franca for everything. So that means that we also have to accept that language and that set rules in order to express the values that we need for society. Maybe that's the most important thing, because I myself, as a person, have also my doubts, maybe linked with one group of your persons who are criticizing your work.
Yeah.
Because I also think why we have to express everything in numbers. But we have to express everything in numbers because it's time that asks for economic issues, arguments, and rules. So we just have to.
Yeah.
And for the second thing, what are the main challenges? We just thought that the first challenge is just to learn how to switch to that different way of perceiving life.
Mm-hmm.
Because we ourselves have to learn. Then we have to learn to teach somebody else. What are we doing to the society? Then it was also Yelena who said a very important thing that we actually didn't do one thing that was very important, and that was to use the global crisis to show all the economic benefits that libraries do to a society.
Mm-hmm.
At least to use it more than we use it. Because we, especially in Croatia, we have a rise in numbers of library users. We have a very, very strong rise. That means that people are using libraries, they need them, especially in the time of the crisis.
But I must tell that we have a low start, because only 15% of our population are using members of public libraries.
Yeah, because you pay your membership. Yeah, I understand.
But
that
it
now.
Is not the reason. It's not the reason.
No.
And then, and also to use our statistical data that we have, because here in Croatia, speaking with our colleague from the ministry, she says neither museums nor galleries nor other cultural institutions, they don't have that type of statistical data that libraries have. And then as a third challenge, it was kind of this idea that we have really to upgrade communication and become louder.
I think that's very important, and that is very important. And statistics, numbers, data can like give you a support to go out to talk louder. Sometimes it's stupid to say so, but it's actually you got it. Yeah, it's another basis. Good, very good reflections. Thank you so much. Anybody else? Yeah.
I'm sure that we have some specific problem that I think you don't have in Denmark,
mm-hmm.
because it's connected with publishers here.
Yeah.
We have other problems when we have users that are coming to libraries and asking for some books on some topics. We don't have anything on that.
Mm-hmm.
And we are dependent on the publishers.
Mm-hmm.
We cannot publish books and translate them or I don't know. But that situation is actually very bad here. So we cannot offer books if we don't have them.
No.
So one of the problem here because we are a very poor country, is to make some developments in that area that our politicians are willing to push more money in this whole area, cultural area, publishing areas, etc. We have we have a lot of topics in science that we don't have any books about. Even we don't even have them in English.
No.
Yeah, and we don't have enough space to put them there.
Yes.
So because you are in Denmark, you probably have, I think, a lot of translations or books on a lot of topics in science. Okay. So we have also parents who are coming to the library and asking for the kids for their books in schools, and we don't enough even those books, and they are telling us, oh, what am I doing here? Why am I coming here at all?
Yeah, because you don't have.
So it's connected with the other problems.
Yeah,
they are just part of the
bigger
problem.
But I think that maybe a way of that could be to talk louder, to start to show with the statistic, with the robust evidence, to start maybe not in this big way, and start small to speak louder with some data, and maybe hopefully to get the attention of the politician to see the importance of the libraries, and maybe connect it to some of these targets, some of the groups saying, okay, these people don't have books for the children, these people don't have. And what would it actually mean to for them to get access to the school books? If anybody else, does anybody else have something to?
I just recalled we at this library, Central Library, City Libraries, we have a practical problem that many of libraries have. It is the lack of space.
Yeah.
We have our library standards, and they say how much space we have to have for this size of population and the number of books. If we go to our politicians and advocate for more money to invest in space, based only on standards, they just laugh at us. They don't understand. They will say, well, you wrote the standards, and it is not such a fixed category. But if we say that a large amount of our books is located at a remote location because of lack of space in some depots, and that we have to spend so much money on bringing those books to our location, the money, time, investing vans or something other material, that is a fixed number that that they can relate to. So I just think of that practical problem and how to solve the practical problem by using the economy category.
Good reflection. But one thing I think is also is about these narratives, because if you where do you want your, I know that this is a practical and economic discussion, and I'm sure that they have hundreds of questions, economic questions and practical questions at the same level. But if you try to, I think sometimes if you want to be able to address that problem, sometimes if you take a more and you change the perspective to open up a proper dialogue. And I think that discussing more general discussion like education, like health, like to say, okay, this actually maybe can open up for saying, okay, and then we need the more space and to be paying books. So changing the dialogue, I think it's an important thing. We don't have any time left. I thank you so very much, and I will just say, I think it's been very inspiring, and also the discussion I had in the break, because one of the things that we will do with this project is, first of all, to gather as much information as we can at LinkedIn at the moment. So everybody who wants, please connect with me at LinkedIn so I can give you access to the group where we can both look at what other people are doing and share knowledge. We will go, when we finish our tour, of course, we will go to see MEPs to see, okay, can we actually affect politicians at European level? But we will also make a kind of script on based upon best the practice in the different countries to say, okay, how can we actually do this in a general way with examples from the different studies? And finally, what we discussed with Ryan Ashley in London was to say, okay, we know how expensive it is to do this kind of studies. Maybe we should do kind of workshop 2 days, inviting all the expensive economists together from London, Denmark, Barcelona, Holland, to say, okay, we know in Denmark we have this result on education and digitization. We have this result in England on health. Couldn't we try to make it to European tools? So you could actually say, okay, it should be possible to say, for example, that health issues has an economic impact at, I don't know, 10 kroner, for example. So we could actually use the works being done in different countries. So we would try to work on doing that so it could actually be possible to use these studies in European countries. But
And also, so it's possible for every country, and also for you to use those kind of arguments in your political debate, both on a local and a national level. That could be very interesting, I think, for everyone.
Well, we would like to say thank you very much for listening to us and participating in the dialogue, and thanking for hosting this event. It's really, really nice, really nice to be in Croatia. So we will be here to have a look at the library.
Yes.
So if anybody has an extra question, you can ask us. But thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.